Hachette Audio presents The Compatriots, the brutal and chaotic history of Russia's exiles, émigrés, and agents abroad. Written by Andrei Soldatov and Irina Borogan. Read by Nick Sullivan. There is no business like it. We are politicians. We are soldiers. And above all, we are actors on a wonderful stage. Leonid Nikitenko, a chief of the 19th section of the KGB, in charge of recruiting agents in the Russian émigré communities in the West. A strong diaspora can only exist if there is a strong state. Vladimir Putin, president of Russia, former colonel of the KGB. Introduction. Toward the end of December 2017, a skinny young Russian with expressive eyes, a stubbly beard, and a slight limp walked into a coffee shop in downtown Washington, D.C. His name was Vladimir Karamurza, Jr., and he was a Russian politician émigré and anti-Kremlin lobbyist. He had lived in D.C. for years, but often traveled back and forth to Moscow, irritating the Kremlin. On a trip to Moscow in spring 2015, he had been poisoned and nearly died. During his treatment in a Washington hospital, he received a visit from an FBI agent who said he had been assigned to Karamurza's case. When Karamurza recovered, he flew back to Moscow, and in February 2017, he was poisoned a second time, experiencing identical symptoms. That was why, 10 months later, he was still limping. The young Russian took a seat next to the window, and a minute later was joined by a tall man in his mid-40s, the FBI agent. The agent had called for a meeting, promising to bring Karamurza some information about his poisoning. At this point, they had known each other for 2 years. "We think we found the active substance you were poisoned with," the FBI agent said. He told Karamurza that the agency was preparing a detailed report and explained that the heads of the Russian secret services would be soon visiting Washington. "We are going to hand the report over to them. That there was an attempted murder of a Russian citizen on Russian territory for political reasons." The FBI's intent, the agent implied, was to send a message that they were not very happy about politically motivated poisonings in Moscow. But some in the agency were more troubled by the strange events happening on their own turf, in Washington. A year and a half earlier, a Russian former press minister and presidential aide had been brutally beaten near his DuPont Circle hotel. He managed to make it to his room and then died there, not far from the coffee shop where Karamurza and the FBI agent were sitting. Those who had beaten the ex-minister to death were never found, and the rumor in Moscow was that he had fallen out of line with the Kremlin just before the incident. The FBI wanted to make its concerns clear to the Russian intelligence community, and the upcoming visit provided a unique opportunity. The heads of all three major Russian spy agencies, SVR, the Foreign Intelligence Agency, FSB, the Domestic Security Service, and the GRU, Military Intelligence, had never before traveled together to a Western capital, but they planned to do exactly that at the end of January 2018. 3 weeks after their coffee shop meeting, the FBI agent called Karamurza again. He didn't offer to meet this time. He just told Karamurza that laboratory results on the poison were inconclusive and that the plan to deliver a report had been called off. Then he hung up. The heads of the three Russian intelligence agencies flew to Washington, as planned, at the end of January. It was very unlikely, given the circumstances, that the report on Karamurza was mentioned at the highly secret meeting. The following month, another Russian, former spy Sergei Skripal, would be poisoned in Britain by two agents of Russian military intelligence. Almost 30 years after the collapse of the Soviet Union, and 20 since Vladimir Putin came to power in the Kremlin, Russians abroad were suddenly in the crosshairs. In January 2018, As the heads of all three Russian spy agencies went to Washington, we went to Paris. In the heavy rain, across the enormous Champ de Mars, the Eiffel Tower seemed unreachable. We were standing at the epicenter of France's military glory. Behind us stood the stately classic complex of the École Militaire, the famous center for French military education, and all around us the avenues were named after French marshals. We decided to keep walking. It was a nice walk, even in the rain. After the winter in Moscow, it felt good to see something other than snow. From the Champ de Mars, we headed down the Avenue Rapp, named after a Napoleonic general who led an attack at Austerlitz that completely decimated the Russian Emperor's elite Chevalier Guard. Our destination was the Pont de l'Alma, a bridge named after a Crimean War battle in which an expeditionary French and British force defeated the Russian army. But our intentions for sightseeing were not historical in nature. Right at that junction stands a brand new complex. Four buildings with facades covered in beige limestone. The building in the middle, topped by five onion-shaped domes, is the Holy Trinity Cathedral, part of the Russian Orthodox Spiritual and Cultural Center. We wanted to see it because although the center had been in operation for only 2 years, it had already sparked large-scale spy mania. Among the rumors circulating, was that the French counterintelligence services had surrounded the complex with jamming devices to prevent the Russians from using the center's facilities for electronic eavesdropping. And we knew that the officials at the French Foreign Ministry, located on the nearby Quai d'Orsay, were pissed off by the Russian government's request that the center's employees be granted diplomatic immunity. We entered through the main doors. Two bulky security guards told us, very politely and in Russian, to open our bags. They checked the insides thoroughly. We crossed the main hall and entered an internal courtyard where the rain was still coming down. But when we tried to sneak into the next building, we were stopped. A man appeared from nowhere and gestured at us to stop and go back. It was clear that we had entered an area that was under careful watch. In an instant, we were struck by that familiar feeling of being on Russian territory, specifically the territory of a Russian government institution abroad. Indeed, we were. The center is the property of the administration of the Russian president, and it is run by people experienced in promoting Russia's foreign policy. The head of the center was a career Russian diplomat, and Bishop Nestor, the prior of Holy Trinity Cathedral, was no stranger to Russian diplomacy himself. He had spent 4 years serving in the Ministry of Foreign Economic Relations, an alliance the Moscow Patriarchate called a symphony between the State Department and the Church. We walked back to the main hall where a handful of French visitors were wandering around, looking at photographs on the walls. Announcements were posted everywhere about an upcoming concert featuring a male choir and an exhibition marking the centenary of the Bolshevik persecution of the Orthodox Church. Indeed, the center was getting ready to embark on an entire year of events commemorating the suffering of the Church under the Communists. The message was clear. Orthodox believers in France, mostly Russian emigrants and their descendants, were invited to come to a church that was clearly under Moscow's control. There they would be embraced by the new Russia, one no longer divided into two groups, the Russian diaspora and Russians still living in Russia, but constituting a single Ruski Mir, Russian world, whose members were all compatriots. Putin latched on the concept of Ruski Mir, the worldwide community of Russian-speaking people whose identity is firmly connected to Russia's history, culture, and language, in the early 2000s. It is a community whose members are, by definition, closely tied to Russia. No wonder Putin liked the idea. It could serve as a good political instrument for promoting Russia's influence abroad. According to Putin, this Russian world now consists of more than 30 million people, with 10 million living in Europe. And, he decided, the Church would provide them all with spiritual guidance. To make this work for the Russian émigrés, two things were needed. First, prominent emigrant families would need to cooperate with Moscow. Second, the Russian Orthodox Church had to be united, and the abyss bridged between the priests inside and outside the country. Putin achieved both sets of conditions. He was not the first to take steps in this direction. His predecessor, Boris Yeltsin, had started a conversation with the émigrés in the final year of the Soviet Union. But Putin's goals were completely different.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.